In the previous video for Chinese film classics, we talked about how the two-part film Spring River Flows East narrates a chronological account of the war and enumerates the effects of the war using the documentary style of categorical form. In this video, we'll talk about the film's use of melodrama and poetry. As a melodrama, Spring River Flows East offers catharsis through identification and condemnation. In representing the travails of a vulnerable trio, a young married woman, her son, and her aged mother-in-law, the film testifies to the common experience of bitter suffering, or ku, which is both shown and spoken of. The film also encourages audiences to deplore the wartime opportunists, and to a lesser extent, Japanese collaborators who profited from the war, and who also speak, hypocritically, of how ku their life is. The war is presented as a trial, which magnifies the inherent virtue or vice of some and corrupts others who are morally weak. In the last video, we talked about categorical form, whereby a film presents subsets of a category, in this case, the war. Spring River also employs a rhetorical form that promotes an argument, ideology, or worldview. Specifically, it alternates depictions of moral and immoral behavior using polar characterizations and parallel editing to praise virtue and condemn vice. We'll talk about these techniques in more detail in a minute. For now, I'd just like to point out in passing that rhetorical form can be seen in multiple techniques in this film, even in just the names of the characters. Zhang Zhongliang's name, for example, means faithful and good, right? It's a good man and true, which of course turns out to be ironic. His son's name, Kang Sheng, means resistance is life, or resistance for life, and his mother calls him Kang Er, which might be translated literally as child of the resistance. Eyeline is also part of rhetorical form. Zhongliang often looks down and off-screen, kind of the shifty gaze of a troubled conscience. Su Fen, in contrast, often looks up and off-screen, as if with aspiration and anticipation. Other examples, big and small, can be found throughout the film. For example, a graphic match, created by dissolving from a shot of the legs of a couple doing the tango to the marching legs of Japanese soldiers corralling Chinese prisoners. Parallel editing repeatedly juxtaposes vice and virtue, dissipated consumption and selfless labor, a climate of selfish opportunism and a community of united mutual aid. Even as Su Fen and her mother-in-law are deprived of the last of their rice and forced into a watery ditch by the Japanese, Zhongliang and Li Zhen are celebrating their wedding at an opulent, drunken banquet. At the banquet, Zhongliang receives a pair of letters that Su Fen had mailed him 3 years ago. But when his new wife demands to see them, he tears them up before her eyes and throws them out a window into the river, as if to tear up his original family ties. Actress Bai Yang, who plays the film's central moral paragon, was then at the peak of her stardom. She had also appeared in Crossroads in 1937 and co-starred with Tao Jin as the romantic leads in 8,000 Li of Clouds and Moon, which was released in Shanghai on February 21, 1947. In 8,000 Li, Bai's character defies her parents and runs off to join a patriotic drama troupe. In Spring River, she is achingly filial, a modern-day Confucian paragon that could have walked out of a propaganda campaign for the nationalist 1934 New Life movement. In repeatedly moving her family members to safety, she even comes across something of a wartime version of an ancient parable about the philosopher Mencius' mother. This is the mother of an ancient philosopher who moved house several times to protect her child. Su Fen, however, is presented as a mother not just of her own child, but of the nation. When she works at the relief center in Shanghai, children call out to her adoringly, asking her to read them stories and mend their clothes. And Chinese audiences seeing the scene may have been reminded of earlier propaganda photos of Madame Chiang Kai-shek stitching a soldier's uniform. Su Fen feeds and comforts the war orphans, putting in long hours with a smile on her face. Su Fen, whose heart is as angelic as her looks, makes sacrifices for her family, ladling out broth for her mother-in-law and son, but denying herself. She also writes letters on behalf of illiterate people to inform their relatives about their most recent wartime miseries. As a scribe, she not only bears her own suffering, but also bears the suffering of others and records their misfortunes. Her final sacrifice, which she makes despite her own concerns about preserving her husband's reputation, is to become a servant in another household, a household which is run by none other than He Wenyan, the Mrs. Tai Tai. The proposition of going into service is so shameful to Su Fan that her self-sacrifice seems comparable to that of Ran Ling Yu's character in Goddess from 1934. Another type of moral paragon that appears in the film is the principled intellectual. In the village scene, the filmmakers introduce a theme that dated back to far before the war, to the early days of the Republic, threats against intellectual freedom. Zhong Min, who's a student, and his fiancée and other classmates are accused of being so-called thought criminals, Sixiang Fan. The former principal, whom they all respect and who has been presumably displaced by a Japanese appointee, has gone off to lead a band of guerrilla fighters. And Zhong Min's group barely escape to join him. Students and teachers have played an outsized role in Chinese politics in the previous decades. During the war against Japan, thousands of teachers and students were forced to flee from their institutions, some traveling as far as from Beijing or Tianjin in the north, thousands of miles down to Kunming in the south. Spring River alludes to this history while creating a revenge fantasy led by the old principal, a scholar turned warrior. Violations of the academy reappear in Crows and Sparrows from 1949, in which protesting teachers end up arrested and killed. Elders appear as another type of ballast in this moral melodrama. In the climax of part one, the Japanese army hangs grandfather for having had the temerity to plead on behalf of starving villagers who have no more grain to turn over to the Imperial Japanese army. An old lady who attempts to escape from the watery ditch is shot in what turns out to be the final Japanese wartime atrocity of the film. These sequences are part of the film's rhetoric of excess, part of their rhetorical form, in which it is those who have suffered the longest, including the wife who has kept her vulnerable family members alive for 8 years, who die the most pitiful deaths. Spring River's rhetorical form contrasts such virtue with appalling vice. The hard work of resistance patriots is put side by side with the self-serving behavior of the moneyed classes. During an early montage of Chinese troops defending Shanghai and civilians fleeing in August 1937, we see a striking shot of men rushing to load a truck for the Shanghai Municipal Relief Association with boxes supporting the slogan, "Vanquish the Japanese devils." A prosperous-looking businessman in a suit looks on smilingly from the doorway of a shop. Wartime profiteering, this brief image seems to suggest, existed from the very beginning. The party at which director Pang introduces Zhong Liang to his managers itemizes the excesses of the corrupt Chongqing set. We have managers who handle cars, another cosmetics, rice, and silk. The centerpiece of the banquet that night turns out to be lobsters flown in from Calcutta and crabs flown in from Shanghai. The cosmetics manager quips that if this is how the war of resistance is going, we could resist for a few more years. The moral drama of Zhong Liang hinges on the scene of his arrival at Li Zhen's house in Chongqing. He is wretched and desperate, and apparently, based on his own horrific suffering, believes his family to be likely dead. For 4 years, he has been working at the front lines, enslaved as a prisoner of war, or as a refugee. Yet the filmmakers begin to qualify the sympathy we have for him pretty much immediately. While waiting for the servant to prepare his bedroom, Zhong Liang discovers a ripped photograph, and he has a sudden happy realization and settles back comfortably into the armchair. Right, already he seems to envision himself as the man of the house. Early in his decline, Zhong Liang still has a conscience, and he rages that he's gone from a hero, Ying Xiong, to a bear show, Gou Xiong. Eventually, however, he is in too deep and he casts his scruples aside. Zhong Liang reaches his career peak and moral nadir at the same time and is set for a reversal. Sex plays an important role in the moral melodrama in this film. Zhong Liang, in one scene, before he's together with Li Zhen, is smoking in bed in Chongqing when we see a vision of his thoughts. When Wang Li Zhen returns home, he feigns sleep, but he then watches her legs as she walks upstairs. And sex is represented as the beginning of his moral decline. He literally xia liu, or goes downward flowing, right? This is a term for decadence. And this progresses as quickly and relentlessly as a river. The perils of separation are also shown to be not just physical, but moral, right? Zhong Liang cheats on his Shanghai wife in Chongqing, and then cheats on his Chongqing wife when he returns to Shanghai. Yet this pattern can't be solely attributed to one man's personal flaws, as the precedent of a husband leaving his wife and then cheating on her is one that Li Zhen knows and fears. The representation of this other woman is complex, and it evolves over the course of the film. Wang Li Zhen is a strong woman, a dominant personality, even domineering, with a robust physique. Her dance performance at the factory is played as outgoing, if somewhat vulgar. And backstage, she asks for Zhong Liang's help in descending from the stage, a physical contact that foreshadows their later relationship. And at that point, a clown actually comes out and mimics Wang's affected cry for help in falsetto tones. When she and Zhong Liang meet by chance in Hankou, she's again friendly. Her personality is quite different from the haughty reserve of her rich family and patrons. Only later is her social extroversion shown to be an expression of corruption, as when she laughs at Zhong Liang and literally shoves cash into his pocket and urges him to forget his scruples at the theater and, somewhat ironically, at the cinema. With her overblown sexuality, Wang Li Zhen is represented as something of a combination of two negative female archetypes, which you can see to some degree in a film from the same year, Long Live the Mrs., Tai Tai Wan Sui. The peevish, manipulative, and vulgar yet seductive other woman, and the rich, smug, and jealous Tai Tai, or wife. Though she suffers at Zhong Liang's hands too, in the end, her attitude towards the dead Su Fen renders her utterly repellent. Su Fen also projects her own sensuality, which is on display in many medium close-up shots, though I think this is also sublimated into her roles as good mother and filial daughter-in-law. Her sexuality bursts through, however, in one striking juxtaposition. When Zhong Liang returns to Shanghai and re-encounters He Wenyan after the war, they immediately have sex. And the scene then cuts to what is perhaps the most sensuous shot of the film. We have this left side, soft lighting showing Su Fen lying in bed in medium close-up. She smiles and nuzzles her sleeping son. As we see in a flashback, she remembers the moment when Zhong Liang put a ring on her finger. The tender memory makes her shed tears, the pathos tempering the passion that has been building inside her for 8 years. The film devotes less attention to Japanese collaborators, except to indulge in a simple fantasy of summary justice. Manager Wen is jailed and loses his wife and wealth. His wife, He Wenyan, played by Shang Guan Yunzhu, who plays the homewrecker Shi Mimi in Long Live the Mrs., is glamorous but immoral and somewhat absurd. So early in the film, Zhong Liang's comrades have made many sets of clothes for the war effort, and Mrs. Wen has managed to produce only a single vest, which she assures him is in the latest fashion. Later, Mrs. Wen visits her husband in jail only to find him talking to his mistress. And back home, Zhong Liang tells her that all of Mr. Wen's accounts have now been put in her name, and she's pretty much sold on her new man. She tells Zhong Liang, "Li Zhen is your wartime wife, so I'll be your secret wife." In part one, as Su Fen is leaving the village by boat for Shanghai, we see an alternative family model to the separation she has experienced. Zhou Min, with his fiancée, who sports a soldier's uniform and rifle, and Xiao San, a boy from the village, are off to continue the fight from the mountains. During the War of Resistance, the patriotic Chinese slogan of the day was "Quan Min Kang Zhan," United Resistance. This wartime family melodrama also extols "Quan Jia Kang Zhan," resistance by united family. The cinematography of the shot we see here, with the trio framed with the kind of adoptive son in the center, looks like a studio family portrait. In other words, we see this idealized image, which presents both the desirability and the difficulty of the wartime ideal of keeping the family together. Spring River Flows East, as I mentioned earlier, works in the modes of documentary, melodrama, and lyricism. In China, the wars of the mid-20th century were the making of poets, a trend that scholar David Derwei Wang calls the lyrical in epic time. Lyrical expression was an important output of war, amidst the predictable calls to arms. Artists in multiple spheres turned to classical sources for inspiration. Writers, dramatists, and filmmakers, like the makers of the film Hua Mulan from 1939, turned to classical allegory. Cartoonists put down the pen and picked up the brush. The film takes its title from the final couplet of The Beautiful Lady Yu, Yu Meirin, a 10th century poem by Li Yu. "How much sorrow can one person bear? As much as a river of spring water flowing east. Wen jun neng you ji duo chou, qia si yi jiang chun shui xiang dong liu." The poem expresses an emperor's lament. Spring River, too, pours out the sorrows, or cho, precipitated by a crippling foreign invasion. The river, a metaphorical image of a rushing torrent of emotion heading towards the boundless sea, becomes a leitmotif, a central reoccurring theme of the work. River images both frame the drama and appear at key moments in the plot. The couplet first appears following the opening credits, and this appears over several shots of a river, including an extreme long shot of a lone boat sailing down the river between mountains. And this is sung at the same time by a chorus in a fevered crescendo. The sequence repeats at the ends of part one and part two, bookending each film. The river shown is China's longest, the Yangtze, or Changjiang. Like the Yellow River, the Yangtze is often invoked as the cradle of Chinese civilization and an ethno-national symbol. Here, the Yangtze is a sublime symbol of epic flows of time and people. Between 1937 and 1945, Chinese refugees numbered an estimated 95 million, or over one quarter of the national population. The river is also a physical location, which is important to this particular war. It is up the Yangtze that the Nationalist Army retreated from Shanghai and Nanjing, past Hankou to Chongqing. In Chongqing, the first time Zhongliang's colleagues take him out partying at night, he begs off dancing and returns alone to Miss Wang's opulent home, to gaze out the window at the eastward flowing river, which he knows leads back towards where his family should be. One night in Shanghai, Su Fen's mother-in-law wonders aloud where Chongqing is. Su Fen points to the Huangpu River, which connects to the Yangtze, and thus to Zhongliang, over 1,000 miles away. The ever-flowing river is one lyrical connection device in the film. You could contrast this to the comic connection devices in Labor's Love. Another connection device is the moon. Zhongliang tells Su Fen before they part that he will think of them on nights when the moon is full. His first glimpse of the full moon occurs while he is tied up on a chain gang. Zhongliang also looks out at the moon over the river just before he commits adultery with Wang Lijun. The scene then immediately cuts back to Su Fen looking out at the moon and remembering his promise to her, only for the wind to rise and black clouds to blow in, covering the moon. The poetic lines and tropes in Spring River Flows East have multiple functions, including the establishment of moral archetypes such as the benevolent mother, the dutiful daughter-in-law, the patriot who laments for a fallen nation, and the faithful lovers who pine for each other from afar. Some of these moral archetypes have classical roots. On the eve of Zhongliang's departure for the front, his mother stays up late at night, sewing him a cotton vest in the semi-darkness to keep her son warm in China's interior. This labor of love, literally in the shadows, puts to shame the showy but meaningless display of the rich missus who has created a single vest. The old woman is the very picture of the Confucian ideal of benevolent motherhood, a point driven home by the ancient poem that Su Fen shows Zhongliang. The benevolent mother, thread in hand, sews a garment for her wandering son. Upon his departure, she makes each stitch tight, as if afraid he will be slow to return. During one interlude in Wen Yan's party, Su Fen goes outside looking for her son, while a singing beggar girl comes by leading a blind old man. The song that she sings, as we see images of old Mrs. Zhang, Shanghai's neon lights, and the begging couple, brings together the trope of the moon, the thematic focus of this film on the family, and the sorrow, or cho, of the title poem. The contrast it evokes recalls one of the most famous lines of the Tang Dynasty poet immortal Du Fu, itself a lyrical expression of rhetorical form. Behind vermilion gates, wine and meat grow rank. On the streets lie bones of the frozen dead. The film's social critique, while persistent, is ultimately subordinated to the grander lyricism of Deluge. At the end of part one, a rainstorm pummels their leaky rooftop shack, and as the storm climaxes, Su Fen braves the thunder, lightning, and torrential rain to repair the window and protect her family. A shot shows Shanghai seemingly drowning, consistent with the watery leitmotif of the war as a torrent of suffering. At the end of part two, Su Fen, in a pathetic gesture of oblivion, quenches her sorrow in the ever-flowing waters. In 1947, when this film was released, war was still raging, And the filmmaker's message with this ending seems to be that suffering, like a river, flows ever on.